السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. ثم أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي، آمين يا رب العالمين. Inshallah, I hope that this is the strangest lecture you've ever attended. So everybody stand up. So now let's begin. Inshallah ta'ala, my intention today is to share with you the importance of the month of Ramadan and talk about it from a perspective that often we don't get a chance to hear. And so I'm going to begin from somewhere that you might not even expect. I'm going to begin with our father, Ibrahim alayhi salam. Now I call him our father because that's what Allah calls him. You know, there are no other prophets. There are no other prophets other than Adam alayhi salam that Allah calls our father. He calls all of the messengers or prophets. But with Ibrahim alayhi salam, he says, Millata abikum Ibrahim. He's the religion of your father, Ibrahim. So we have this, not only a relationship of respect and honor for Ibrahim alayhi salam, and even love. We love the messengers of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam. But when Allah calls him our father, there's a different kind of emotional attachment. Additionally, that we have to this man, Ibrahim alayhi salam. Now we're going to talk about two sons of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Who's the older son? You can call it out loud, it's okay. That's loud, go wait. Very good, Ismail. The older son, Ismail alayhi salam. Then, Ishaq alayhi salam. So we're going to talk about two sons. I did not hear you that time, so I'm going to ask you again. Who's the father? That's better. Who's the older son? Ismail. Who's the second son? Ishaq. So first we'll focus on Ishaq alayhi salam. By the way, Ismail and Ishaq, both of them are prophets. Both of them are prophets. Ishaq alayhi salam has a son. Ishaq has a son. His name is Ya'qub. So who's the grandfather? Ibrahim alayhi salam. And the son is? Ishaq. And the grandson is? Okay, now we've got three. Ya'qub has another name alayhi salam. Ya'qub has two names. His name is Ya'qub, his name is also Israel. His name is also what? Good. Let's start at the top. Grandfather. Good. Son? Grandson. Ya'qub, whose other name is? Man, if somebody finds out, you guys were all saying Israel out loud, there'd be a problem. Israel is a blessed name. It's the name of a prophet. Now, Israel has a son. Ya'qub has a son. Actually, he has 12 sons. But one of them is a prophet. Ya'qub has a son who's a prophet. Who? Ah, Yusuf alayhi salam. So the great-grandfather is Ibrahim alayhi salam. Then the son is Ishaq. Then his son is Ya'qub or Israel. And then his son is Yusuf alayhi salam. How many sons did Israel have? 12. So those 12 sons had 12 families, and those families then became bigger families, and those families became tribes. So they became the 12 sons of Israel, from there the 12 tribes of Israel. You with me? That's where you get the 12 tribes of Israel from. How many sons did Ibrahim have, did we say in the beginning? We're focusing on one of them, yes? Which one? Ishaq. What seems to be happening with Ishaq? Ishaq is a prophet? His son Ya'qub or Israel is also a prophet, whose son Yusuf is also a... So it seems to be one generation after the next, after the next, after the next, every single time there is a what? A prophet. And even the ones we don't know, the prophet, our prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would tell us, كُلَّمَا هَلَكَ نَبِيٌّ خَلَفَ نَبِيٌّ. Every time one of them would die, every time a prophet would die among the children of Israel, another one would take his place. So there was never a time in their entire history that they did not have a what? That they didn't have a prophet. They kept getting prophet after prophet after prophet after prophet after prophet. It's incredible. It's incredible that they received all this revelation. And of course, then came one of the greatest prophets. That's even one of the greatest prophets in the Quran, the most talked about prophet in the Quran, Musa alayhi salam. No one Allah talks about, nobody more than Musa alayhi salam in the Quran. You know, by name. And he came among the children of Israel. And his brother was also a prophet. Who's that? Ah, Harun alayhi salam. But even after them, prophethood continued. Yusha, for example, prophethood continued all the way through. Now, let's stop here for a second. Let's go on the other side. Who was the other son? Ismail alayhi salam. Whose son? We don't know. We don't know. He's definitely not a prophet. Who's also other child? Not a prophet. Grandchild? Not a prophet. Great-grandchild? Not a prophet. Generations keep going. Any prophets? No. The score on this side is very high. And the score on this side is zero. You with me? Okay. Now, let's go back. Who was the older son? Ismail alayhi salam. Ibrahim alayhi salam was with his older son, and they raised the foundation of a building. What building am I talking about? The Kaaba. Oh, thank you so much. Because these interrogation lights are so hot. So, okay. So which son are we talking about now? Ismail alayhi salam, who helps his father build or raise the foundations of the Kaaba. Okay. So they're raising the foundations of the Kaaba, and they both together make a dua. What did I do now? What did I do? Oh, you want water too? Okay. No, it's okay. It's cool. Thank you for the flowers. They're very nice. Okay. So they're raising the foundation, and as they're building the Kaaba, they pray. And they make a few du'as. So I'm going to only highlight two of them for you. One of them, they say, رَبَّنَا وَجْعَلْنَا مُسْلِمَيْنِ لَكْ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِنَا أُمَّةً مُسْلِمَةً لَكْ. Our Master, please make both of us Muslim, just for you. Which means, Ya Allah, make us people who submit before you. At least make both of us. Now who is both of us? Help me understand. Ibrahim and Ismail, make both of us Muslim before you. And among our future generations, at least one nation that is Muslim. وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِنَا, our future lineage, there should be at least one Muslim nation also. How many nations did they ask for? One. Okay. Then they made a second dua together. And the dua was, رَبَّنَا وَابْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ. The ayah goes on, I'll just highlight this part. Our Rabb, send or appoint, raise a messenger from among our children. How many messengers did they ask for? Send a messenger from among our children who will recite your ayat, your revelations onto them. On the side of Ismail alayhi salam, the dua was, how many messengers should come? One. How many came on the other side? Every generation, yes? Every generation a prophet is coming. And on this side, Ibrahim alayhi salam only asks for how many? One messenger. That's it. It seems as though he's asking for a messenger who is going to be so powerful, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that this one is heavier than all of them put together. Because they've got a lot of score, don't they? But this one should be enough. And not only should he be enough, what were Ibrahim and Ismail alayhi salam doing when they made that dua? What were they doing? They were raising the Kaaba. The Kaaba was made for Muslims, for the Arabs, for the... Who was it made for? Do you know? وَإِذْ جَعَلْنَا الْبَيْتَ مَثَابَةً لِلنَّاسِ. It was made for all humanity. It was made for all humanity. So if there's going to be a messenger who he's going to pray for while he's building the house, that is for all of humanity. Inna awwala baytin wudi'a lin-nas, for all humanity. Then that messenger has to be one who is not a messenger for the Arabs or the children of Ismail only. He has to be a messenger for who? For all humanity. That is why he is more significant and more powerful and more important even than all of the other messengers put together on this side. But does he come right away? The dua was made in the middle of the desert. Ibrahim alayhi salam is making the dua alongside Ismail in the middle of the desert, and they say at least a messenger should come. Did he come in the next generation? Did he come two generations, three generations, four, five, six, seven? Oh my God, thousands of years went on. And the other side keeps scoring. They get a messenger every time, yes? They keep getting books every time. And if things got so bad on this side, on which side? On the Ismail side. Things got so bad, they built a masjid, yes? Al-Masjid al-Haram? They built a masjid.
But that masjid, people, their children's children, even forgot that that was a masjid. Forget that they stopped praying anymore. They actually turned it into a temple. They put idols there. And they started worshipping idols at a masjid. At a masjid. Isn't that shocking? You know, after a few generations, sometimes people are less religious. Maybe sometimes you look at a picture of your grandfather or your great-grandfather and they look like they're a lot more religious than you or something. And as generations go by, people lose the religion more and more. But can you imagine, they were started off as Muslims, and generations go by and now they're worshipping idols. And not even worshipping idols at some temple. They're worshipping idols at the masjid. That's what they were doing. Now I'm going to go on from this subject, but on the side I want to mention something else. A few young people came to me recently, because in the news, you know, you see sometimes very angry Muslims, they like to destroy idols. Okay, so they go into a temple and they'll destroy the idols in a temple. Or they'll go into a museum and they'll break all the idols, all the statues. And when they break the idols and the statues, they argue that this is what Ibrahim alayhi salam did. You guys know about that? That Ibrahim alayhi salam broke statues? Yes? And also the Messenger of Allah did it too, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When did he do that? When he conquered Makkah, yes? Then he broke the idols. So I saw some videos, these young people are breaking the idols and they're reciting the ayat in which Ibrahim alayhi salam broke the idols. Like they're fulfilling a sunnah of who? Ibrahim alayhi salam and of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is so, so bad. It's so bad. It's such a lie against the Quran and lie against the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Let me tell you something about Ibrahim alayhi salam. Allah says, وَتِلْكَ حُجَّتُنَا آتَيْنَاهَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ. Those were our ways of making an argument that we gave only and only to Ibrahim. In other words, Allah told Ibrahim alayhi salam to do things, He never asked anybody else to do them. They were only and only for who? For Him. That is why He as a person is called an ummah. He's not an ummah, he's a man. But inna Ibrahim kana ummatan. He had license to do things that nobody else had to do. Did you ever see any messenger, any other messenger of Allah, turn to the sun and say, this must be my Lord. Hada Rabbi, hada Akbar. You see that from any other prophet? No. Did our own messenger do this? No. This was only given to who? Ibrahim alayhi salam. Did you see any other messenger being willing on his own to be thrown into a fire? Okay, go ahead. No resistance. Only Ibrahim alayhi salam. Ibrahim alayhi salam is the only one who's told to slaughter his own what? If you really want to do everything Ibrahim alayhi salam did, sharpen your knives, my friends. Ibrahim alayhi salam is the only one who's asked to take his family, his wife and child, and leave them in the middle of a desert. Leave them. And you know, leaving people in Makkah is, you know the weather. You guys know it better than I do. Has any other prophet been asked to do something like that? No. Ibrahim alayhi salam is the only one who destroyed idols. There are so many prophets mentioned in the Quran. Did any one of them, when they made da'wah, did they ever destroy idols? But somebody says, no. What about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Yes? Because the prophet destroyed idols, yes or no? Okay, let's try to understand that. The best one to act on the ayat of the Quran, to show us how do you live by the ayat of the Quran, is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yes or no? So the ayat of the Quran came that Ibrahim alayhi salam broke the idols. These ayat came in Makkah, Makki ayat. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in Makkah. And what was around the Kaaba? Idols. And the ayat came that Ibrahim alayhi salam broke the idols. Okay, so you know what? He should act on these ayat. And what should he do? Destroy the idols. As a matter of fact, Ibrahim alayhi salam, did he have an army with him when he destroyed the idols? Did he have a lot of forces? Did he have a bulldozer? How did he destroy the idols? On his own. Did he have a lot of power? No. As a matter of fact, for breaking the idols, they were ready to throw him into a what? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam does not have an army in Makkah. He's also in a position of weakness. So he should follow the sunnah of his father, Ibrahim alayhi salam, and do what? Destroy the idols. But did he do that in Makkah? No, not in the early life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know why? Because he didn't understand those ayat the same way some people think they understand them. The best one to understand and act on the ayat is who? the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and if he's gonna, and if you're thinking he decided he should wait another 20 years before he destroys the idols, when have you ever heard that the revelation of Allah comes and a messenger says, I'm not gonna act on that yet, I'll act on it later? That doesn't work. But then the brother comes to me and says, but you know, at the end of the Prophet's life alayhi salatu wasalam, when Mecca was conquered, what did the Muslims do? Starting with the Prophet himself, they destroyed the idols. And I said, of course they did. That was a masjid. If you see idols in a masjid, what should you do? Destroy them. How do we know that's a masjid? Who built it? Who built the Kaaba? Call it out. Come on, speak up. Ibrahim alayhi salam built a temple or a masjid. And later on his children put what there? Idols there. So those idols should be removed because the masjid should be kept clean. Especially from shirk. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not go to some temple and destroy idols. He cleaned a masjid. أَنْطَحِّرَ بَيْتِيَا لِلطَّائِفِينَ وَالْعَاكِفِينَ وَالرُّكَّعِ السُّجُودِ. What are you talking about? That you get to go around into other people's houses of worship and destroy their idols? And then you say this is something the Rasul of Allah did sallallahu alayhi wasallam? What is wrong with you? Anyway, let's go back to the story. By the way, the topic today was supposed to be Ramadan, yes? I'm confused because I started talking about Ibrahim alayhi salam instead. I'm sure you're confused too. That was my point. I wanted to confuse you because it is about Ramadan. And today I'm going to try to show you how Ramadan is all about Ibrahim alayhi salam. Ramadan is all about who? Ibrahim alayhi salam. Okay, let's explore that a little bit. How many pillars in Islam? I can't hear you, I'm sorry. Oh, that's better. Okay, five. First one. Oh my God, this is that hard, Kuwait? Should I ask easier questions? Shahada, very good. Then? Salah, okay, good. Third? Come on, it's coming. Fasting. Salah, zakah, fasting, and what? Hajj, okay. You know that four out of five go back directly to Ibrahim alayhi salam. Four out of five. Ibrahim alayhi salam was raised in a family where they worshipped idols. He was in a town that everybody worshipped idols. The only one who stood up for La ilaha illallah, yes or no? And his children carried the message of La ilaha illallah for generations, yes or no? And he built the house that would make sure that people would only worship how many gods? One, he is the father and the teacher of La ilaha illallah for all the other prophets that came before him. Even our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is told, فَاتَّبِعْ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا. Follow the legacy and the religion of your father, you know, of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So La ilaha illallah, the teaching of La ilaha illallah, also is a legacy of who? Ibrahim alayhi salam. What's the next pillar? Salat. Ibrahim alayhi salam says, La uhibbu al-afilin. I don't love the things that settle. You know when he looked at the sun and he said, that can't be God, or the moon can't be God, remember that? Right? You know, you guys know the story. I'm not going to tell you that story again, but I will tell you one thing about that story. The biggest thing you see from your eyes in this life, the greatest creation of Allah, there's no bigger creation than that you can see with your eyes, is what? It's the sun. There's no more power, and you guys see the sun a lot. You know? So you have the sun, the moon, the stars. The sun, the moon, and the stars. And Ibrahim alayhi salam describes that he does not like things that change their position and settle. What happens to the sun throughout the day? It settles. Every time the sun moves its position, it's time for another salah. Yes or no? We remind ourselves that the sun is not all powerful, it's not always there. It changes, it moves, it becomes weaker and stronger. And so we remind ourselves every time the sun moves its position of remembering the greatness of Allah. And by the way, when the sun is at its weakest, Maghrib, when the sun is at its weakest, then all of our prayers get louder. So you'll notice all the prayers in the dark, Maghrib, Isha, and Fajr are loud when the sun is out. Subhanallah. Even that, and by the way, Ibrahim alayhi salam's dua, many of you know it, رَبِّ جَعَلْنِي مُقِيمًا. It's his dua. Master, make me someone who establishes prayer and among my children. So the fact that we do aqim as-salah is because of the dua of who? Ibrahim. So shahada goes back to Ibrahim alayhi salam. Salah also goes back to who?
Ibrahim alayhi salam. Okay, we'll skip zakat. What's next? Fasting and Hajj, yes? Fasting and Hajj. Fasting I'll talk about last, because you might not think it's about Ibrahim alayhi salam, but it is. We'll talk about Hajj. Hajj has nothing to do with Ibrahim alayhi salam, does it? I mean, we go make Hajj at the Kaaba, well that's kind of Ibrahim alayhi salam. There's a place right next to the Kaaba, this place, some people love hugging it. It's called Maqam what? Ibrahim. Oh, okay. Okay. And of course, the fact that we go there and we drink the water of... That absolutely has nothing to do with Ibrahim. Wait, no, that too. Oh yeah. What about running between Safa and Marwa? That has nothing to do with him or his family, right? Oh, that too. Oh God. Okay, at least one thing has nothing to do with Ibrahim alayhi salam. Slaughtering the animal at the end has nothing to do with Ibrahim alayhi salam. Oh wait, that too. The entire Hajj is actually a celebration of the legacy of who? Ibrahim alayhi salam. Even Hajj goes back to Ibrahim alayhi salam. You with me? Which one do I need to explain to you? I said 4 out of 5. So which one do I have to explain to you? Fasting. That's why I brought it up. That's why I talked about Ibrahim alayhi salam and his two sides of the family and the generations. So I can make this one point. Ibrahim alayhi salam was building the Kaaba alongside his son who? Ismail. And they made two du'as. One du'a was at least one nation that is Muslim from our children. And what was the next du'a? At least send them one messenger. Now here's my question. What will that messenger do? He said, this is what the messenger will do. يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. He will recite your revelations to them. He will teach them the book and the wisdom. And he will purify them. He will purify them. So this is what the Prophet will do, alayhi salatu wasalam. When Muhammadur Rasulullah finally came, sallallahu alayhi wasalam, what was his job? To purify, yes? To recite what? So what are these ayat that Ibrahim alayhi salam asked about? What are they? They are the Quran, aren't they? They're the Quran. Ramadan came. Ramadan is important. Why? شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه. So after centuries and centuries and centuries and centuries, finally the du'a of Ibrahim alayhi salam is answered in the month of Ramadan, and finally these children can be cleansed because of the word of Allah and the final messenger that has come. This night, the Quran came in one night. It started in one night. Which night was that? Laylatul Qadr. Inna anzalnahu fi Laylatul Qadr. So then we should have had one day of party. Quran didn't come in the entire month of Ramadan. Quran came on the night of Laylatul Qadr. That's it. But this Quran is so important that Allah took one day of celebration and turned it into what? 30 days of celebration. Ramadan is actually an entire celebration that the du'a of Ibrahim alayhi salam was answered. That's actually what we're celebrating. The entire month of Ramadan goes back to who? You understand that? You with me so far? Okay, it's time for your first break. How much time do I give you? These are five. I'm from Pakistan, let me tell you. These are not Pakistani 5 minutes. These are actual 5 minutes. These are not Sunni 5 minutes either. Those are more like 55 minutes. I'm going to be over here. Sisters, you can ask whatever questions. Then I'm going to come back up here. I'm going to turn the mic off for how long? 5 minutes. Make friends, make enemies, do whatever you want. After 5 minutes, when I come back, I'm not going to say, brothers and sisters, calm down, please listen, stop talking to each other. I don't care. I'll come back and I'll start talking to myself. I have 6 children, I know how to talk to myself. I have no problem with that. Is that clear to everybody? In the last discussion, I talked to you about Ibrahim alayhi salam's relationship with Ramadan, yes? Now we'll talk to you a little about this other family. This was Ismail alayhi salam, the other side was what? Ishaq alayhi salam. Every generation, they kept getting prophets, yes or no? You know, when you have something all the time, stop appreciating it. You get used to it. And you don't really take care of it. So what happened with them? They stopped respecting their prophets. Started making fun of their prophets. Things got so bad they even tried to kill their prophets and killed some of them too. وَيَقْتُلُونَ النَّبِيِّينَ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ. Then things got so bad
that when Allah finally sent them one of His greatest messengers, Ruhullah, when He sent him Isa alayhi salam, not only did they try to kill him, but on the first day, the guy's a baby, he's a baby, and they're still calling him a liar. And they're accusing his mother. They didn't even wait for him to grow a little before they attacked him. They attacked him from the day he was born. They even went after his mom. And as he got a little later, they tried to kill him altogether, conspire and kill him. That, as far as Allah is concerned, that was it. No more prophets for you. When Isa alayhi salam was taken up, 6 centuries went by, 600 years went by, and children of Israel got no prophets. They got 0 prophets. They were waiting for that one last one to come. But you know what? The last one that came, what did they try to do to him? They tried to kill him. So Allah removed that honor from them, and they stopped getting prophets. And they kept waiting and waiting and waiting. And some of those children of Israel used to live in Arabia, and they were actually convinced that the last one will come in Arabia, and that's why they moved to Arabia. There are actually companions of the Prophet ﷺ that used to be rabbis, they used to be Jewish. And they said, our families moved to Arabia because when we studied our books, we realized that the last one that's coming is coming where? In this region. He'll come in this region. They actually, one Sahabi even showed the Prophet ﷺ a letter that was written 6 generations ago of people who moved there hoping that they get to see the last messenger. So they were hoping that this final messenger will come, but come on which side of the family? The Ishaq side or the Ismail side? The Ishaq side. Now let me tell you something crazy that they did. You know that, you might know this, but some children of Israel, if they're ready to kill prophets, then you understand they're ready to change the book of Allah too. They're ready to change the book of Allah. Allah gave them prophet after prophet after prophet on this side. How many messengers did Allah promise on the other side? One, even one was too much. For them, even one was too much. We don't want anyone on that side. So you know what they did? They changed the story. They changed the story into Ibrahim alayhi salam saw a dream that he was supposed to slaughter his son, and so he took his son Ishaq and he tried to slaughter him. Even though we know the truth, the son that was taken was who? Ismail. And that is why an animal was sacrificed in his place. Which is why even for thousands of years, even though the people of Arabia forgot about Ibrahim alayhi salam, and they forgot about Ismail alayhi salam, they still used to sacrifice the animal. They kept that practice alive. Where did they get that practice from? They got it from the original teachings of Ibrahim alayhi salam. I hear, you know, it's on a tangent, but an important note, is a brilliant scholar from India, one of my heroes, actually, in Islamic history, who passed away in the early 1900s. His name is Hamiduddin Farahi. What an amazing scholar. This scholar, even though he's an Indian scholar, he only wrote in Arabic. He traveled, you know, extensively throughout the Arab world in the 1800s, and he studied. And he was a great mufassir of the Quran. He wrote a tafsir of 9 surahs. And he decided that because of one ayah of the Quran, which is يَعْرِفُونَهُ كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ, they know him like they know their own children. Because of that ayah, he decided to understand the Hebrew language so he could understand the Torah, the book given to Musa alayhi salam. He could understand it by himself. So he decided to spend 10 years learning Hebrew. And then when he studied Hebrew and studied the language for 10 years, then he did exhaustive research on the Torah and he wrote a book. Again, a book in Arabic, and I hope it gets translated soon into English and other languages. The book is called Ar-Ra'yu Sahih Fi Man Huwa Al-Dhabih, the correct opinion about who was to be slaughtered. Because the Muslims say that the son to be slaughtered is who? Ismail. And the Jews say that the son to be slaughtered is who? Ishaq. And some people argue, what's the big deal? Either way, you get to have barbecue at Eid. So no problem. There is a problem. And let me tell you what the problem is. When they changed their books, they made some terrible lies. Terrible lies. They made a lie that Ibrahim alayhi salam had 2 sons. One of them was blessed and the other one was cursed. And the one that was blessed was chosen for the sacrifice and the one that was cursed was left. And the one that was cursed, he will be of the devil, and his children will be of the devil, And the religion they follow will be the religion of the devil. And they said these things about who? Ismail. And to make it worse, then they accused Ismail alayhi salam of being illegitimate. He wasn't even married out of wedlock. You know, he's a child of zina. Ma'adallah. They were even willing to accuse their own father Ibrahim alayhi salam to make Ismail look bad. They were willing to do that. And they changed the story and made it about who? Ishaq. By the way, the Jews created this story, and some of the rabbis created this story, and later on in evangelical Christianity, which is a very powerful form of Christianity in the United States, for instance, they took that story and they made it theirs too, so the Christians followed it too. And now if you go to Texas and you listen to the radio, and you listen to Christian talk radio, they're going to say, Muhammad, they don't say Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, follows the religion of the devil, because he's from the children of Ismail, you see. And he's from the devil. And it all began with what? That change in the story. It started there, and it trickled down. A lot of the hatred people have towards the Arabs is actually because of that deviation. SubhanAllah. Now, we don't believe that one side is cursed and the other side is blessed. We actually believe both sides are who? Prophets. They're both blessed. We have a much better view. We don't have the reaction, oh, you think our side is cursed? We say your side is cursed. No. We don't have that. We don't have that problem. We don't have that problem. Now, they changed the story. Ibrahim alayhi salam is now, you know, his blessed children and then his cursed children. But when the Prophet is born, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and when the Prophet is known as the Prophet at the age of 40, this is a big shock for them, because apparently the final messenger came at the wrong address. So they had to change their books and say the one to be slaughtered was who? Ismail. By the way, after the slaughter, after the, you know, the animal was to be sacrificed, and Ibrahim alayhi salam passed the test, part of the graduation ceremony was, now you get to build the Kaaba with your son who passed the test with you. That's why they built the Kaaba, after passing the test. Now, according to Hamiduddin Farahi, they did something really interesting. They said he took his son Ishmael to a valley with a spring of water. That sounds like what? A valley with a spring of water. Sounds like Mecca. A hot valley with a spring of water, and then they added, the place was called Sakka. That's cool. Take one letter off, Mecca, and make it what? Sakka. And then he took him for sacrifice between Shifa and Mura. Between Shifa and Mura. What does that sound like to you? Safa and Marwa. And Hamiduddin Farahi even showed, the word is written like this, they made it like that. And it became Shifa to, you know, Safa to Shifa, and Marwa to Mura. What a scam. They didn't even do a good job hiding it. It's still there. Some of them recognized that is the last messenger, but they couldn't take it. They could not take it. Now we talk about Ramadan. Now we're going to talk about Ramadan and tie all of this together. Did you know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam given Ramadan, or given fasting, even before Ramadan? Muslims used to fast even before Ramadan. The ayah about that was recited today. Ayyuhalladhina amanu kutiba alaykumus siyam kama kutiba alal ladhina min qablikum. Those of you who have iman, fasting was mandatory upon you, was made mandatory upon you, just the same way it was made mandatory on those who came before you. This is why the Prophet ﷺ used to fast on the same days as the Jews. Before Ramadan, he used to fast on the same days as who? The Jews. Because according to us, what they have was given by prophets too. Unless Allah wants us to change it, we'll follow the same thing that was given to previous prophets. We don't see ourselves, the children of Ismail, and the Prophet, he does not see himself as a different messenger with a different religion. It's the same religion, it's just the other side of Ibrahim's family. That was Islam and this is Islam. So there's no problem. So they used to fast on the same days as the Jews. As a matter of fact, we also used to pray in the same direction as the Jews. Which direction? Al-Aqsa, Jerusalem, yes? The Kaaba is right there, but we used to pray towards Jerusalem. That's what we used to do. Same days of fasting? Same days of what? Same direction. Even the celebration of Ashura. You know where it comes from? It comes from Musa alayhi salam. And the Prophet alayhi salam said, we have more right to celebrate it than they do. You know? Wow, every single major event, early on, the Prophet alayhi salam is doing exactly the same thing as they are. But you know what? They had their chance. The last messenger that was given to them was who? I already told you. Isa alayhi salam. And they lost their chance. No more chances for them. And the Muslims are now going to be taught that you have to become a new nation by yourself. You have to become a new nation, a Muslim nation by yourself. Whose dua was that? At least from our children, make one new Muslim nation. Ibrahim alayhi salam. It's time to fulfill that dua. Now listen carefully. We are going to become a new nation. When you have a new nation needs a new capital. Yes or no? So now the capital is changed from Jerusalem to what? Mecca. And a nation should have a founding father. Who's the founding father? Ibrahim alayhi salam, founding father. The capital is what? Mecca. A new nation should have its own constitution. What's the constitution of this ummah? The Quran. And the day on which the constitution begins to be implemented, that is the independence day of that nation, yes? And an independence day is supposed to be celebrated, yes or no? Allah said, forget Independence Day, I will give you Independence Month, which is the month of Ramadan. Everything changed. We became a new nation. As a matter of fact, every year when we celebrate Ramadan, we celebrate becoming an ummah once again. All of it comes together. And by the way, this is why every one of these things come together in Suratul Baqarah. Suratul Baqarah. And it's in Suratul Baqarah that Allah called us a new nation. وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا, a balanced, a middle nation. It is Surah Al-Baqarah in which Allah changed the capital from Al-Aqsa to what? Al-Masjid Al-Haram, to the Kaaba. You know? And then on top of all of this, the fasting was given to you like it was given to the people when? Before you. And Allah says about the people before you, fasting was given to you so that you can have taqwa. And in my third session, I'll talk to you about taqwa. Not now. Right now I want to finish the history side of things. Wrap up this history session. Inshallah, then I'll give the brothers some chances to ask questions. Then I'll talk to you about taqwa. But now listen. Ayyama ma'dudat, only a few days. The fasting of the Jews back in the day only used to be a few days. Ma'dudat in Arabic means less than 10. Jam'u qilla, a few days, not 30 days. Single digits. And there were two rules. I won't go through the entire ayah. I'll just remind you of two rules. If you miss a fast, back then, if you miss a fast, you have two options. You can make it up, or you can pay someone, or you can feed a poor person. Feed a poor person. What are the two options? You can make it up out loud. You can make it up, or feed a poor person. Those are the two options that used to be there when we used to fast the same way as who? The Jews. That was the two rules. Was it 30 days or just a few days? Okay, few days. Now we're going to talk about the ayah of Ramadan. When Ramadan came, Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned that the most important thing that makes Ramadan special is not fasting. Ramadan is not important because you're fasting. Ramadan is important because it's the month in which the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam was answered. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. The month of Ramadan is the one in which the Quran was sent down. Now that's so important, it's so powerful, that later on, I'll explain the later part earlier to you. How many days is this fasting? This days of fasting is how many? 30 days, sometimes 29, 30, right? Is that more than before or less than before? This is more than before. And this time, if you miss a fast, you have to make it up. But you don't have the second option, which is what? Just feed. If you want, feed. You have both options equally. No. Now you have to fast 30 days in a row, and instead of having two options, you only have one option. Fidyatun ta'amu miskin is not mentioned anymore. It's gone. That's only for exceptional cases. Now, it seems as though things got harder. Because a few days turned into 30 days, and two options to get away turned into what? One option. Things are getting harder, yes? And when things are getting harder, Allah says, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرِ Allah wants ease for you. He doesn't want difficulty for you. وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرِ. Just as things got harder, He told you and me, He wants things to be easy and not difficult. And I got confused when I first studied this. I said, Ya Allah, first of all, You made things more difficult. And then You said, You want things to be what? Easy. If You wanted things to be easy, You should have had even less days. And even more options, even a third option. If You don't want to do anything, stay sleeping. Things have certainly gotten harder. And He says He wants things to be easy. This is what we'll get to by the end of this discussion. Why are things easier now, even though they look harder? Let's go back to the beginning of the ayah. The month of Ramadan is the one in which what was sent down? So the first thought in the mind of every Muslim, when they think about the month of Ramadan, the first thought is the Quran, according to Allah. The first thought is not pakore, not samosa, not ketchup, not the fries. It's not iftar. I know what some of you go through in Ramadan. You know, when you think about Ramadan, all you think about is, how well you're going to sleep during the entire day. You know, you get up for suhoor, eat a few bites, pray fajr somehow, and then pass out, wake up for zuhur. Then you pass out again and you wake up out of your coma for asr. Very close to maghrib. And then between asr and maghrib, you usually sit at the dinner table 30 minutes before the food even comes out, and you just, you know, get your plate ready, put the ketchup there, make a mountain of ketchup, stare at it. That's our fasting, mashallah. And then when finally the adhan comes, you know, there's supposed to be a dua. That's the fastest dua you ever make. And then you eat so much that by the time Isha comes around, you're like waiting for the Imam to say Allahu Akbar. You're hoping that he can telepathically hear you. Just say Allahu Akbar. Just say it. Just say it. And when you go into ruku, it's hard to come out. And a lot of people, when they go into ruku, people think they're having a high iman. What they're doing is, oh, yeah. And then when you go into sajda, when you're getting up from sajda, some people think this person has so much high iman that they stayed in sajda extra long. You don't have high iman, bro. You're just so tired and so relaxed. Oh my God. That's what we've done with Ramadan. Ramadan was supposed to be about what? Quran. I won't give you a long lecture about this. I'll highlight a few things that we ignore. First of all, Ramadan is a month in which you will rekindle, refresh, restart your relationship with the Quran. There are scholars sitting among us. There are imams sitting among us. There are hufadh of Quran sitting among us. I'm a student of the Quran myself. I've been trying to understand this book for the last 15 years. But when it comes to the month of Ramadan, I will start over like I never knew this book. I'm going to start over. Like I have zero relationship with this book. It's time to refresh my sense of a Muslim, my commitment to my father Ibrahim alayhi salam, and my appreciation of the answer of his dua. I'm going to start from zero again, like I don't know anything. Nobody should assume they know anything about Quran when the month of Ramadan comes. Start over. He says, "Hudal lin nas." It is a guidance. And by the way, the word Quran means things, something that is recited a lot. So the purpose of the Quran is to get recited. If you're not reciting the Quran, you're not going to ever find its purpose. You have to exceed in your recitation of Quran. I have to do that too. He says, "Hudal lin nas." Guidance for who? When he says, "Hudal lin nas," what does that mean? Guidance for who? All humanity. But wait, I thought Ramadan is about the Muslims. Now Allah is saying it is guidance for who? All humanity. This is a very powerful thing because the people who came before us were also given a book. They had a constitution. What was their constitution called? Torah. And Torah was for who? All humanity? وَجَعَلْنَاهُ هُدًى لِبَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. We made it guidance just for the children of Israel. But now Allah says this book is for who? All humanity. And He specifically mentioned that in the month of Ramadan, because in it there is a very beautiful gift. In the month of Ramadan, Allah will soften the hearts of people all over the world, Muslims and non-Muslims. So we have a chance for 30 days to share the guidance of Allah with who? All humanity. The greatest da'wah opportunity to share the word of Allah is the month of Ramadan. It's not just about you. It's not just about the Muslims. If it was only about the Muslims, it would have been hudal lil muttaqin, like in the beginning. But here he says hudal lin nas. Guidance for people. Guidance for people. Why? Because when the Quran first came down, when it first came down, wasn't the Prophet's job to share it with people? So now when you're going back and starting over again, isn't it now your job to share it with who? People? You're being reminded that this is your responsibility. We have made Ramadan into something that is only for ourselves. We have to understand Ramadan is a gift of Allah to all of humanity, and we, the Muslim Ummah, the one that Ibrahim alayhi salam prayed for and our father Ismail alayhi salam prayed for, our job is to deliver that gift. Especially in the month of Ramadan. And especially because in the month of Ramadan, the shayateen, the devils are what happens to the devils? They are chained. And when people are not being influenced by the shayateen, then their hearts are softened, even when they're not believers yet. And they have a chance to maybe hear something that was from their, you know, from the dua of their father. He's their father too. He made dua for all of them. What a chance. Hudal linnas. Now let's move on. وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ. The clearest of proofs from within guidance. This part is a little bit hard to understand. I think I can make it easy though, if you guys pay attention. You guys paying attention? You need to stand up again? I think you do. Stand up. Stretch again. Say salam. No, don't say salam anymore. Just twist your back a little bit. Yeah, good. Get your blood flowing. It's good for you. Okay, have a seat. Almost done with the ayah. Then I'll give you your next break. وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ. What does it mean? Guys, prophets came before, yes or no? When prophets came before, Allah sent two things with them. Allah sent a message, and Allah sent a miracle. I'll say that again. Prophets used to come with how many things? What were those two things? Message and miracle. Musa alayhi salam's message was one thing. His miracle was something else. They're two separate things. Miracle was the staff, for example. The staff that he used to hold is his miracle. But that is not his message. His message is that Allah is one. It's just that he's a messenger of Allah. His message is the Torah. But his miracle is the staff or the hand. These are two different things, yes? So they always used to be two different things. Until the Quran. When Allah gave us the Quran, He gave the Prophet ﷺ the message. The message is what? The Quran. And what's the miracle? The miracle is also the Quran. It's together now. It's never been before. It's never been together before. Now you know, the miracles of Allah cannot be defeated. The miracles of Allah cannot be what? Defeated. But the message of Allah can be changed. Was the message of Allah changed in history? Torah was changed, yes or no? Because you can change the message, but you cannot change or defeat the what? Miracle. Quran is the message and the miracle. That's why it can't be changed. If it was just a message, you could what? You could do what with it? You could change it, but this is the miracle too, so you can't change it. Now, that's why Allah says, clear proofs from within the guidance. Even though it is the message, it is the guidance, it in and of itself has miraculous proofs. It in and of itself proves itself. This is unique to the book of Allah. So what I'm trying to get across to you is, the first thing is, recite Quran, understand that it's guidance for you and guidance for humanity. That's the guidance or the message part of it. But also understand that it is a miracle from Allah. وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَىٰ. It is clear proofs from within guidance. It's miraculous. We have to now appreciate the Quran as the word of Allah. I'm going to take 5 minutes to explain this concept to you because I think it is an absolutely critical concept for Muslims all over the world. I believe, after having traveled quite a bit around the world and talking to a lot of Muslims, interacting with them online and seeing emails and Facebook posts and things like that, that a huge, huge number of Muslims around the world are starting to doubt that the word of Allah is perfect. They're starting to doubt that the word of Allah is perfect. This is a reality. A lot of young people in college, a lot of people that are working professionals never got a good foundation in Islam. As a matter of fact, we did a terrible job in Islamic education. Most people don't know the message and they don't appreciate the miracle. They don't. They don't know what that's about at all. You know, the purpose of a miracle is it convinces you without any doubt. It convinces you, it leaves no doubt behind. We didn't do a good job explaining the message, and we didn't do a good job explaining the miracle. And when you don't do that, obviously what comes next? Doubt. That's what comes next. You have a huge number of young people that are having doubt. And it's our job to actually refresh and reintroduce people to the miracle of this deen, the perfection of the Quran. I will just on this note, since we were talking about Ibrahim alayhi salam, I'll share one small miracle with you. One small thing. Ibrahim alayhi salam lived in a village or in a town where everybody worshipped what? What did I say? Idols. But when he talked about Allah, he talked about three things that could not be God. They could not be God. What three things did he talk about? The sun, Ash-Shams, the moon, well, Al-Kawkab, which means Jupiter, the brilliant star, Jupiter. Al-Kawkab in Arabic refers to Jupiter. I'll repeat that. What three things did he refer to? Sun, moon, and not star, Jupiter. Jupiter. Looks like a star, but it's a planet. Now, about 5 years ago, they were doing excavations in ancient Babylonia region, some parts of Iraq. Excavations were being done by, you know, archaeologists, and they actually found a city buried 40 feet under the ground in the desert. 40 feet under the ground, there's an entire city. And the biblical scholars and Christian and Jewish scholars are all in agreement that this is the city of Ur. Ur is spelled U-R. In the Bible, the city of Ur is the city in which Ibrahim alayhi salam was born. When they dug into this city, they found literally thousands of idols. Every household had different idols. There's a massive collection of them. Idol after idol after idol after idol. They collected, I think, nearly 5,000 of them. Now, these idols are of different sizes, different denominations, etc. But they actually figured out that three of them are the biggest ones. There are three man-sized idols. One of them is a man, and his head looks like the sun. The next one is a man, and his head looks like the moon, the crescent moon. And the third one is a man, and his head is shaped like a planet with a ring around it, and a brilliant star, which is what? It's Jupiter. Their three main gods were the sun, the moon, and Jupiter. The Bible says they worshipped many idols. It makes no reference to the story about the sun, the moon, and Kawkab. No reference. The only place you'll find that mention is where? In the Quran. Allah tells us things that humanity couldn't have known. Humanity couldn't know. And that's just one small example. The list goes on and on. This is bayyinatin min al-huda. But bayyinatin min al-huda means one more thing. It's important for you to know. In your personal life, Allah will show you miracles. When you come to the book of Allah for guidance, Allah will show you miracles in your personal life that only they're only for you. You cannot prove them to anybody else. Well, it'll come a time in your life where you're depressed, or you're worried, or you're scared, or you have anxiety. And you come to the book of Allah, and you open up the Mus'haf, and you start reciting, and the first thing you recite is the answer to your problems. It'll happen over and over and over again. And you'll be shocked, like, how? How did he do that? How did he just solve my problem just like that? And you cannot go to someone and prove that to them. That is a special miracle of Allah given to who? Given to you, personally. That's a gift of Allah to you. Those are bayyinatin min al-huda too. Here are proofs from within guidance. When I was in my previous lecture, I actually talked about this. I shared one of the personal miracles for me, what Allah gave me. And I still can't understand it. So I'm a terrible, terrible khatib. I don't prepare khutbah at all. You know when I think about the khutbah? About 10 minutes before the adhan. It's a horrible practice. The reason I do that is I study the Quran most of the time. And so my way of thinking about what khutbah I'm going to give is, which ayat am I going to talk about? That's all. There's a shelf in my head and I pull out an ayah and I talk about that ayah. That's all I do. Sometimes I can't make up my mind, even when I get up on the minbar, I say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I sit down, the adhan is going on, and I'm thinking, what am I giving a khutbah about? People think I'm looking at them, I'm just looking in confusion, like, what's going to happen? Then finally I say, okay, yeah, that ayah. Oh, this ayah from Surah Al-Shu'ara, or this ayah from Surah Al-Tawbah, or this ayah from, you know, Surah Al-Mulk, or something. And then I pick up a copy of the Mus'haf, and I open the Mus'haf. The last 15 years, every time I open the Mus'haf, it's on the page I was thinking about. Allah does that every time. And I'm like, and it shocks me every time. How did that happen? How did that happen? You know? Allah will give you small gifts in your life, just if you show Him love of this book. That's not for anybody else, that's for who? For you. Then He says, Wal Furqan. And He will make the Allah gave this Quran as a distinguisher, as a separator between right and wrong, between the word of Allah and the word of a human being. It will become very clear to you what Allah wants you to do. If you come to Him sincerely, there won't be any confusion left. Yes, today is the age of confusion, over information. Yes, but when you come to Allah's book with sincerity, Allah yaj'al lakum furqanan. He will make a way to separate the right from the wrong for you, give you clarity. I cannot give you clarity. A scholar cannot give you clarity. Books will not be able to give you clarity. At the end of the day, true clarity can only come from who? From Allah. And He will give it to you if you come to His book. Especially if you come to His book month in Ramadan. Wal Furqan. I'm almost done here. So hear me out. فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْهُ. Whoever of you witnesses the month, then he should fast. That's what Allah says. Whoever of you... What does it do with the month? They witness the month. Why did He say that? In order to witness something, you have to be asleep or awake. Tell me. You have to be awake? In order to witness something, you have to be awake? Kuwait, listen. In order to witness Ramadan, you have to be what? Oh, wait a second. Well, Ramadan is when you get your best sleep. Ramadan is when you pass out, you're in a coma most of the day. And Allah solved your problem and told you that is not right. Because if you're sleeping, you're not witnessing the month. You're hibernating in the month. You know, you're sleeping through the month. You're surviving the month, but you're certainly not what? Witnessing the month. The days of Ramadan are for sharing the message of Allah. The nights of Ramadan are for your worship. To you, right now, the days of Ramadan are for your coma, and the nights of Ramadan are for your late night parties. That needs to change. The night is about getting closer to Allah, the day is about sharing the message of Allah. That's what it is. فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْ وَمَنْ كَانَ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرًا. I'll skip the rules. Allah, I already told you, Allah wants what for you? Remember that? What does Allah want for you? Let's now talk about this ease. How is it easy? Remember I told you the fasting got increased? It's more difficult now? So how is it easy? So let me give you some examples. You guys have heard of police training or military training, or even some people go to college or medical school, right? That's also a kind of training, yes? Now there are two students. One of them is studying every day. One of them is getting ready for the test. One of them is constantly reading and studying and memorizing and preparing himself. And the other one is constantly sleeping, relaxed. And he tells his roommate, come on, man, it's okay. Just relax, you're only going to be young once. One of them is partying the entire weekend, and the other one is studying the entire weekend. And then the exam comes. Who fails and who passes? You already know. 10 years later, which of them has an easy life, which of them has a difficult life? The student who worked hard and went through pain has a what? Easy life. And the student who was partying now has a what? Difficult life. So the student who worked hard got a good job. One day he went to McDonald's. I don't know why he went to McDonald's, but he did. And his friend is serving him French fries. Yes or no? If you want ease now, what will you get later? Difficulty. If you want ease later, what do you have to go through now? difficult. You have to have difficulty now so you can get ease later. That's how the world works, by the way. If you want to become the number one athlete, you have to go through very painful training. The ease, the joy of having the medal and winning the Olympics, all of that, that's later. Right now is just about the pain. How badly do you want to get to that championship? If you want to be top of the class, you have to sacrifice some weekends. You can't watch movies like the rest of your friends. You have to go through pain. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? I'll give you one more example about health. There's two people, one of them takes care of their health, another one does not take care of their health. One person does exercise, wakes up early, goes to sleep on time, eats right, doesn't eat junk food, all of this. A lot of caution and that's not easy to do. It's not easy to do. And their friend eats whatever they want, sleeps whenever they want, doesn't exercise, nothing, easy life. 30 years later, one of them is still walking like this, and the other one is walking like this. Yes or no? One of them has blood pressure, diabetes, you know, one of them has heart problems, and the other one is playing tennis at the age of 55. No problem. Why? Because they went through difficulty when? In the beginning, and they're benefiting throughout. Yes? 30 days of training so you can have 11 months of ease. 11 months Allah will protect your taqwa. This is what the purpose of this training is. Allah wants things to be easy for you. He wants to be for you to be able to defeat shaitan easily. If you truly take advantage of Ramadan, you are ready to defeat shaitan the rest of the months. If you don't take advantage of it, you will have difficulty. And the fact that some people fall right into evil, right into sins, as soon as Ramadan is done, you know what that means? They didn't get their training done right. يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرِ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمْ الْعُسْرِ. Now, وَلِتُكْمِلُوا الْعِدَّةِ وَلِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. Three phrases, all three of them golden. It's so beautiful. And this is what I'm going to end my talk with, inshallah ta'ala. These three phrases. He says, لِتُكْمِلُوا الْعِدَّةِ, so you complete the count. You know, any training has to have a set number of attendants and requirements. And when you fulfill all of the requirements, only then you can graduate. Yes or no? So if you fulfilled all of the requirements, you completed all of them, then you are ready to graduate. Allah says, I did this so you can complete your training. لِتُكْمِلُوا الْعِدَّةِ. Then he says, وَلِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ. Then at the end of that training, you complete your studies or your training, you graduate. Graduation is a kind of celebration, yes or no? When the training of Ramadan is complete, it is time to celebrate celebrate our graduation. What is that graduation called? It's called Eid. And the way the Muslim celebrates Eid is they say, Allahu Akbar. That's why when we celebrate something, we say what? Allahu Akbar. So Allah says, وَلِتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ. So you declare the greatness of Allah the way He guided you. We'll come back to this phrase. This is going to be really important for you to understand. Why do we say Allahu Akbar? We don't say Allahu Akbar because we don't know how to clap. Like, you know, the speech ends, some guy in the back goes, Takbir! And the rest of you are sleeping, one guy goes, Allahu Akbar. It's so funny, this takbir business we do. I'll tell you a silly story. I used to teach kids. And these kids, they don't know anything. They don't know anything. But this kid knew, this one little boy, 6 years old, he knew that every time somebody says takbir, everybody says something really loud. And they say what? Allahu Akbar. But he couldn't understand what it was because it's so loud. So he didn't know what the word was. So one time, this kid is sitting there, and one of the other kids answered the question correctly, and the teacher said, everybody, takbir! And he said, Abu Bakr! But anyway, coming back to why do we say takbir? You'll understand when you understand the purpose of fasting. Understanding the purpose of fasting. Our dear teacher told us in the first, you know, in the ayat of fasting, Allah said, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. So you can get what? The purpose of fasting is so you can get taqwa. How many people have heard a khutbah or a lecture about taqwa and the importance of taqwa, 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 taqwa? You heard it before? Taqwa is really important, isn't it? You're supposed to have taqwa. I've heard so many talks about taqwa, I'm confused. When I was younger, we have to have taqwa, you have to have taqwa, you have to have taqwa. And I said, where do I get it? Is it on sale outside? I don't know where to get this thing from. How do you get it? Everybody keeps telling me you have to have it. Okay, fine, I want it. Can I have it, please? You know? So we talk a lot about you have to have it, but we don't talk enough about what? How do you get it? This is the gift of Allah. Allah gave you fasting so you can get taqwa. Let's understand how, because that still doesn't make sense to most people. How is me being hungry going to get me taqwa? How does it work? Let me tell you. Inside your body, when you fast in Kuwait, inshallah, when you're fasting, about 12 o'clock, what are you going to feel? What are you going to feel? Thirsty, yes? Thirsty. And when you feel thirsty, your throat is going to send a signal to your brain. Give me water. I am dry. It hurts. And your brain will come to your heart. Oh, some Pepsi right now. Yes? About 3 or 4 o'clock, your stomach will issue a complaint. Send a signal to your brain saying, what's going on up there, guys? Where's the customer service at this restaurant? Thing down here, you know, we need some help. Your throat will complain and your stomach will complain. Yes or no? And your heart will look at food and it's going to look so amazing. When you look at that chicken, you're not looking at the chicken. The chicken is looking at you. Come on. Yes or no? It's happened to me. Plenty of chicken has looked at me. So now, there's only one part of your heart. One part of your body, sorry. I gave it away. One part of your body that is not dying. And that's your heart. And so, yeah, I gotta stop. You gave me water. Thank you. I was talking about fasting. I wasn't really thirsty, but okay. So your stomach complains and your heart says, shut up, I'll give you at Maghrib. Your throat complains to your heart and your heart says what? Hey, not until what? Maghrib. The entire day your body is fighting with you, and the entire day who is winning the battle? Your heart is saying, no, not yet, not yet, not yet, not yet. Yes or no? For the entirety of the fast, your heart defeated your body. And when your heart defeats your body, your heart, by the way, the Prophet would tell us, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, at-taqwa ha huna, at-taqwa ha huna, at-taqwa ha, taqwa lives where? In the heart. فَإِنَّ ذَلِكَ مِن تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ. That is, this is part of the taqwa of the hearts. The heart wins and the body loses. For 30 straight days, you prove to yourself that your heart is strong enough to even fight the basic need of survival. Drinking and eating are survival needs. And you are even able to crush your needs when your heart becomes strong enough. Which means Allah proves to you that you are strong enough. Your taqwa is strengthened. As your body is weakened, your heart is strengthened. And not only is it strengthened by this ability to crush these other limbs and put their demands down, but Allah strengthens your heart even more, because in the month of Ramadan, what are you listening to more? What are you reciting more? What are you memorizing more? What are you understanding more? What are you crying over more? The Quran. And the Quran lives where? It lives in the heart. بَلْ هُوَ آيَاتٌ بَيِّنَاتٌ فِي صُدُورِ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمِ. The heart becomes stronger in the month of Ramadan. And that's how you get taqwa. That's how you get taqwa. It's incredible. There's no way somebody who did that for the sake of Allah, fought their temptation. Your spouse is halal for you, you stayed away. Your food is halal for you, your drink is halal for you, you stayed away until the time of Maghrib. There's no way somebody goes through that and they don't develop a strength of being able to hold themselves back. Because it teaches you restraint. It teaches you, fasting teaches you restraint. And at the end of the day, this entire life, وَأَمَّا مَنْ, you know, وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى. مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى. At the end of the day, this entire life is about restrain yourself from certain things. Hold yourself back. Ramadan is the ultimate training for it. SubhanAllah. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Allah says, so you can graduate. And finally He says, وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. So that you can be grateful. This is what I'm going to end with. Please listen to this part carefully. Well, you know what? Just so you listen to it carefully, stand up again. This will take 10 minutes or less. I promise. Stretch, stretch, stretch. Come on. It's nice and hot in here. Okay, have a seat. Have a seat. This is probably the most important part of my talk today. This is the last part of my talk, and it's the most important. If you forget everything else, just remember this part. For brothers, that's already done. Okay, you already forgot everything anyway, so. Sisters, the part you remember is which part? This part, especially sisters. Allah says, وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ, so that you can be what? Grateful. When is someone grateful? When is someone grateful? When does someone say thank you? When something good happens to you, when someone does you a favor, you say what? Thank you. In order to say thank you, you have to appreciate something. Yes or no? Someone who is grateful is the opposite of someone who complains. Yes or no? Someone who is grateful is positive, and someone who complains is what? Negative. Allah says at the end of the entire exercise of Ramadan, the biggest thing that should come out of it is that you should be grateful. And being grateful is impossible if you are what? Negative. If you complain, if you're depressed, if you're sad, if you're angry, if you're saying, why did this happen to me and why did that happen to me? Some of you have suffered a loss of a loved one and it's hurting you a lot. And I respect your pain. I respect your pain. But at the same time, I understand that this, when you have gratitude before Allah, Allah will give you and give them more than you ever imagined. لَإِن شَكْرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you're grateful, I'll increase you. Allah gave you the blessing of being able to protect your heart, develop your taqwa. And when you truly have taqwa of Allah, the first thing that comes out of the taqwa is that you become a positive person. You are constantly grateful to Allah. You're always looking at the bright side. Stop complaining about how things are bad, how the weather is bad, how the ummah is being attacked, how things are so negative all around us, how nobody cares for you, nobody respects you, nobody likes you, everybody's mean to you, you hate your mother-in-law, etc., etc., etc. Stop complaining. Become a person of what? Gratitude. A person of gratitude is positive in their own life, and people around them start becoming positive. You become, your positivity becomes contagious. Ramadan is actually about bringing joy to people's lives. Ramadan is about the Quran, and the Quran is supposed to bring happiness to you. بِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا. Because of that, they should be overjoyed. Quran should bring you happiness, not depression. Some people are depressed, and when they study the Quran, they bring their depression to the Quran. The book of Allah is a book. It's a book that brings light to the heart. It makes you a positive person. I have never read or appreciated any word, any book that is more positive than the book of Allah. Never. Never. So when people start thinking that the book of Allah is negative, and it's dark, and it's, you know, it's depressing, I don't know what book you're reading. Maybe it's your own depression. It's your own negativity that you're reading into the book. Please understand something. The problem Muslims have, and many of you in the room have it, and your family has this problem. We are extremely negative people. We are extremely negative people. We complain about the people around us. We're constantly sarcastic. We're always making comments, putting someone or something down. You see something good, you say, oh, but you know, You have to complain about something. Some of you husbands are so programmed to complain that if she makes the best food, you have a bite and you actually like it. Something inside you says, don't say you like it. Don't say you like it. That's positive. We don't do that. If it had just a little more salt, it would have been better. You have to say something. And then she'll say, should I put more salt? No, it's too late. You should have thought of that before. By the way, I hate your mother too. Some sisters are so negative. Constant negativity. You're constantly picking on your kids. Constantly complaining about them. Stand like this, sit like this. Why are you doing that? Stop complaining. This is actually something that will naturally come to you. This joy will come to you. And you'll become a positive person in all of your feelings. One of the benefits of Quran. One of the benefits of this month of Ramadan. And I pray that Allah Azza wa Jal gives all of you that joy. You know? That closeness to Allah Azza wa Jal. the closeness to the word of Allah. The way to develop a relationship with the Quran is my final advice. How do you do that in the month? We talked about it's the month of the Quran, but how do you practically develop a relationship with the Quran? I'll give you two or three tips and we go pray. First tip, when you recite Quran, try to understand the meaning. And when you understand the meaning of an ayah, turn it into a dua. Understand the meaning and turn it into what? A dua. How? Alif Lam Mim. Ustaz, how do you turn that into dua? Well, Alif Lam Mim, what does it mean? What does it mean? Well, it means something, but what does it mean? Allah knows. I don't know, yes? Ya Allah, teach me what I don't know and keep me away from things I don't need to know. Don't make me curious about things I don't need to know. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ There's no doubt in this book. What's a dua you can make? Ya Allah, don't put any what? Any doubt in my heart. هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ It is guidance for people who have taqwa. Ya Allah, give me what? You give me guidance. Make me from the people of taqwa. You can do this yourself, can't you? Study an ayah, read an ayah, understand what it means, and think about how do you turn that into what? A dua. One easy way to connect with the Quran. The second way you can easily connect with the Quran. Study the Quran, read the Quran. There are going to be things you read you don't understand. Is that going to happen? Yes. So you're going to develop questions. Yes or no? Write your questions down. Start writing your questions about the Quran. And once you have these lists of questions about this ayah and that surah and that ayah and that surah, then start looking for the answer. That seeking of the answer is going to build your love of the Quran. And when sometimes you'll hear an answer and it won't be satisfying to you, and you'll say, Ya Allah, give me, help me understand this so I can better appreciate your word. And when you finally understand the answer, your heart will feel a joy you've never felt before. Because one more treasure of Allah just opened up to you. Collect your questions. Write them down. It makes it easy to engage with Allah. Third, last one. I gave you two tips. What were the two tips so far? I don't remember anymore. You remind me. Turn it into a dua and write down your questions. Here's the last one. You take some part of the Quran, not a big part, a small part of the Quran, and you listen to somebody's explanation. It doesn't have to be mine, because mine are pretty boring. I'm sure you find somebody whose explanation of the Quran is good and you can appreciate it. Listen to an explanation of the Quran for some small passage, a surah, but not necessarily Surah Al-Baqarah, something small. And so you listen to the same thing 4, 5, 6 times. Yeah? And once you listen to it 4, 5, 6 times, make it a point that in the month of Ramadan, you will memorize that surah. Just that surah, even if it's one page, even if it's half a page, even if it's 3 lines. Doesn't matter. Take a small bit of Quran, listen, not read, listen to an explanation, and memorize that surah. You know what's going to happen? When you start praying, and you recite those ayat, you're going to automatically remember the meanings. It'll just come to you. Your prayer will become better. You know Arabic. I told you not to read as much, because when you read, you quickly forget. When you listen over and over, what happens? It stays in your head. There's things you heard 10 years ago, you still remember. Listening has a different effect. So listen, inshallah ta'ala. That will help you, bi-idhnillah. Okay? So those were my three for how, inshallah, you can improve your relationship with the Qur'an in the month of Ramadan. I pray that Allah does that for all of you and myself, bi-idhnillah ta'ala. Now, I'm going to share this crazy thing with you, and I'll let you guys go. I'm going to be making an announcement in Ramadan. It's a pretty big announcement. I think that we can change how Islam is thought about all over the world. I believe we can defeat Fox News. I believe we can defeat Hollywood. I think we can do it. I don't think it's hard. I don't think it's hard. How much media did Ibrahim alayhi salam have when he made the dua for a messenger? How many people were around him? Do you remember? He made dua, send a messenger among them. Who was with him? Ismail. Was there a camera there? Was there a recording crew there? Was there a publishing house there? Nobody. Who heard the dua? One child. A few generations later, who remembers the dua? Nobody. Because his later generations became mushrik. Yes or no? Centuries went by. Thousands of years went by. And the dua was answered. Yes or no? It was answered in the exact same place where the dua was made. Yes or no? And when that dua was answered, it changed the entire planet Earth. Yes or no? Allah took this one dua, and when He answered it in that desert, that one place that had no universities, the Romans had universities, they had no infrastructure, the Persians had infrastructure, they had no philosophy, the Indians had philosophy. They had no brick roads, they had no structures, they had no towers, they had no cities, they had no scholarship. The vast majority of the people were illiterate, and He gave this final word of Allah in that desert. And today, the entire world is shaped differently because of those words. Allah does not need billions of dollars to do something. He does not need satellite or internet to do something. He does not need government support to do something. He doesn't need any resources to do something. He just says, "Kun fayakun." And He gives those unlimited resources. The unlimited resources is the support of Allah. There's no bigger resource than the support of Allah. When you have that, it's all done. And He gives that support to people who genuinely want to serve His deen. And I believe, because when you try to spread the word of Allah, when you try to explain the Quran to people and spread the word of Allah, that you are fulfilling the dua of who? Ibrahim alayhi salam. Dua. We know that dua already has qubul. That dua has already been accepted. And Allah loves to support that dua. He loves to do it. If we become part of that project ourselves, there's no stopping it. There's no stopping it. It's like trying to stop the rain. You can't. It's like trying to stop the sun from beaming down. You can't. It's impossible. It's impossible. I have some pretty crazy ideas that I'd like to implement. I don't think they're that crazy actually. I know people, when I tell them, they think it's crazy. But I will tell you about them in the month of Ramadan. I won't tell you yet. I won't tell you yet. So you'll have to find them online, inshallah. I hope that this Ramadan is your best ever. I make dua for you and your family. Please make dua for me and my family. I pray that Allah makes memorization of Quran easy for you, learning Quran easy for you, sharing Quran easy for you, reflecting on the Quran easy for you, loving the Quran easy for you, acting on the Quran easy for you. Allah Azza wa Jalla increase our love of our Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, and continually increase our love of our father Ibrahim alayhi salam, and may Allah make us part of the people who fulfill his dua. May Allah make us an honored part of that dua. Thank you so very much. You've been a very patient audience. I made you do all kinds of strange exercises and you complied. You've been very cooperative. Let's go to the back, inshallah ta'ala, and pray. Please listen to their announcements. It's really sad when they make announcements and you're not listening. It hurts my feelings. The team, I know they said not to applause, but I think really the volunteer team that put this program together, please give them a huge round of applause. They're really, mashallah, wonderful people. And they know. I test their patience a lot. Every time I come here, I give them such a hard time. Oh my God. But they're still, you know, they're so cool. And maybe that's why. I like to mess with people so much when they're nice. So, you know, the brothers that I've given a hard time to, my apologies to you, but it will continue to happen. Inshallah. Barakallahu li wa lakum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.